Welcome to University Bookstore. I'm Nancy Pearl.
Yay!
And tonight I have the absolute pleasure of talking to Lisa Scottoline, who I've known. We met in 2004.
Oh my
or
God!
Or 2005, I think.
We were like 20 years old.
We were
extremely young.
We had our babies in our arms.
Yeah, we were nursing.
And Lisa was nice enough to select my book, More Bookless, to be the Today Show book club pick. And we were on the Today Show.
Oh. And they didn't know what hit them.
And we just like bonded. We just hit it off. Lisa was dressed in what I have just verified. I've always told people, when I've told people about being on the Today Show with Lisa Scottoline, I've always said, and she was wearing this beautiful, what must have been a Chanel suit.
Oh yeah.
And I just verified that it was a Chanel suit. It was absolutely gorgeous. And
thank
she
you.
Just looked absolutely beautiful. And we just stole the show from,
well,
I think it was
we
Ann
did.
Curry,
you were
wasn't
dazzling.
It?
Dazzling. Well, the thing is, when you're gonna be on the Today Show, you get to buy a suit and deduct it. Come get me, IRS. It's too good late.
Yeah, right, it's past that.
Yay!
So Lisa's in town because she has a new book. It features Bennie Rosato, who is was her first character.
Right.
Not the first character in your life, but the first character in your book. So we're going to talk for a while, and then we'll open it up to questions, and it'll all be on tape, as Mel said, and you can rewatch it, and we'll try not to swear, although we tend to do that together.
We keep it real.
Right, down to earth, keep it real. So for those of you who haven't read any of Lisa's books, or don't know anything, or just wandered in, I doubt that that's the case. But her first book was published in 1994.
I know, there were horses and buggies.
And that was called Mary Had a Little Lamb.
No.
Everywhere that Mary went.
I know, it's a very common mistake. In fact, they held the first signing in the children's book section, thinking it was a children's book. No, there is a stalker in this book, it's just a bad title.
I knew it was everybody.
My second book was called Final Appeal, and everybody thought that was called Final Approach. So, my titles kind of suck.
So where did Bennie come from? I mean, she stayed with you from 1994 to now. You've had taken a break from her now and then and done some standalones and some nonfiction.
Right.
With your daughter, which we'll talk about.
Right. I think you know, probably everybody who's trying to write anything worth reading is going to write. I always have that great quote by Francis Ford Coppola. Nothing in my movies ever happened, but all of it is true. Like, that's kind of a great quote, right? I say it's a great quote, but I didn't say it. That's not an impressive way to start, really. But the truth is,
better to say, as Francis Ford Coppola once said to me.
Oh, yes. Right, in my Chanel suit. He was wearing Chanel too, it was incredible. So whenever you're writing any kind of character, you're plumbing something inside you that's emotionally true, and you have to be real vulnerable. So this is me saying to you that Bennie Rosato is sort of a lot of things that I wish I were. Naturally blonde. Does that even exist? Tall. Really smart. Really confident. She was a rower and I was a rower, but I sucked at rowing. That's a literary term. Should we define that for them? Try to follow along. And I wanted to be just all those things she was. Because I'm much more like Mary DiNunzio in my books. Like short and she's a better Catholic than I am too. But Bennie really comes from, it's aspirational for me. Uh-huh. When I actually want to, I got an email from somebody once who said she was getting her divinity school exam and she channeled Bennie Rosato. And I was like, well, okay, so now we're both going to heaven because this is going to be excellent.
When you were working on that first book, well, talk about your education. You have a law degree.
Yes.
So talk about how you went from law and practicing law to writing, what that transition was like.
So, like, in short, and we should acknowledge a great friend of mine in the audience, Jim Scarantino, was in my law school class and has just finished his first novel, set here. What's the title again, Jim?
The Drum Within.
The Drum Within, and it's wonderful, so you will see it soon. Coming to a shelf near you.
And you were always near each other because it was Scottoline and Scarantino.
Because his last name is Scarantino, and my name is Scottolini, and we were the only Italians in the whole entire class. Yeah. Isn't that funny?
Here's another
pen offer. A3! It's a highly literate reader base. How I got started, as unimpressive as it will be, but is completely true, is it was my first divorce that led me to my life of writing. I loved being a trial lawyer. It's the coolest thing ever. I really enjoyed it for all of the drama that there is in the law. You know, right and wrong and ethical and unethical and justice and injustice, and I really felt that. But when my marriage went south, right about the time my daughter was crowning is what she hates when I say that, but that's kind of true. It's like, oh, time to go. And so it kind of ended. And then I thought I would go back to work because I really did love it. But I just loved being with my daughter. I loved it more than anything. I kind of still love it more than anything. And so I said, well, I've got to find another way to make a living. And there was a guy named John Grisham. You know, the truth is, in crime fiction in particular, the women were still pouring coffee. Mm-hmm. Just saw, there's no other way to say it. Mm-hmm. We were not main characters. And I was a woman lawyer, and I thought, I know they exist. I mean, you can have ovaries and a law degree. Think about it, and the vote. And is my bitterness showing? I'm just still like, trying to keep a lid on that.
It's so Please don't.
So negative. So then I said, well, why don't you give it a try? There's about 5 to 6 years of terrible rejection. But actually good rejection, you know. The one rejection letter I always cite is the one from a New York agent who said, I don't have time to take any more clients, and if I did, I wouldn't take you. You know, I see that guy every year at Book Expo.
Really?
Last year, where I was keynote.
Did you tell that story?
Oh, no, but I thought about it. And, you know, he called to me after he wanted to get my attention. I didn't hear him. I was like, I don't hear you. I don't have time to talk to anybody, and if I did, I wouldn't talk to you. I don't like people who, you know, that's the coolest thing about this country. I mean, look around. We're in this bookstore. All these titles. Wonderful books, all these different voices in a country that celebrates diversity of voice. Like, the First Amendment is the First Amendment for a reason. So I want to hear all the voices, and anybody who cares about books, anybody who really cares about books should want to encourage those voices. So I still never forgive him for being mean to me. I keep hate alive. That's what my mother taught me, to keep hate alive.
I do too.
Is it? Yeah. See, now you would guess it from me. Would you guess it from her?
No.
The dark side of Nancy Pearl.
I've cultivated that persona.
We need to talk, yeah. Girl.
But I'm going to do somebody suggested that I do a Twitter, because I have a Twitter, you know, Nancy Pearl underscore Pearl,
yeah,
is my
to, yeah.
Twitter thing. But but somebody suggested that I do one called Bad Nancy. And then I can really express
it. Could be Nancy Black Pearl. Piratical Nancy Pearl.
So okay, so after that guy rejected you,
yeah,
you got an agent.
I didn't give up. I was on fire. And actually, as Jim will tell you, I was living on credit cards. I got to like 38 grand in debt. At 21% on Visa. You could get money from the mob cheaper. Don't ask me how I know that, but I'm just telling you. And at that point, I started to get scared. I got to 6 years and my daughter was ready for kindergarten, which was my secret goal. It was really to be home with her. And so I kept setting the book out, but I got a job as a law clerk for the Third Circuit Court of Appeals, which that's a cool job, but that's a job when you get when you're out of law school. Like, it's not so cool when you've kind of gone off course and kind of, you know, gotten divorced and your roots are really long, but you can't afford to get it done. It's a nightmare when you look like you've been in a prison for too long. Jeez, these are like felonious roots. So I, not now though. Now, anyway, I'm being silly. So 2 weeks into that job, my first novel was bought, not for a living wage. And by the way, you have to pay all the debt back. I paid it back. And like just yesterday. And but then I just kept at it, and the first novel was nominated for an Edgar, which is like good in suspense. I lost. But then the next one was nominated and I won. I wear the same exact outfit to both ceremonies. I figured no one saw it the first time. Could not afford Chanel in those days. But feel lucky. I feel very lucky. I'm lucky for all of these people. I'm lucky to have met you. I really love you. You're great. She's a national treasure. Seriously. Yes. You need to hear that from the outside because you're used to her. But I was looking forward to this whole tour to seeing Nancy again and meeting her again and playing games with her and having fun.
So okay, so can I ask you a question?
You can ask me anything, honey. You know. Am I shining?
Why did thinking. When you?
I'm thinking.
You're thinking.
Yeah.
Are you trying to channel
NPR
my question?
Plot, narrative, allegory. Go.
You go. But so you would never have published the book under like initials like L. Scottoline. You wanted it to be. You know, you wanted a woman, because that was still early, and as you said, there was John Grisham, but there weren't a lot of other women writing legal thrillers,
right.
Were there?
Who? Well, no, there were not.
Right.
There's two separate points here. The first is, are you a woman writing, and the second point is, are you writing a woman main character?
Right.
Now, I know the right answer to your question. The right answer to your question is, I would never have been considered under my initials. But the true answer is, sometimes I wish I had. Because I'll tell you the truth. First of all, they did want to publish me as Lisa Scott, by the way.
Really?
Because they said, this last name is incomprehensible. And I said, it ain't that bad. And, Jesus, H. And plus, my dad always said, tell people that it rhymes with fettuccine, which I'm like, Dad, I'm trying to be taken seriously. I don't know. It's not like a menu. And I also don't care if people mispronounce my name. I'm not like a jerk about that. I'm a jerk about other things. So it was really important to me that there be in the ether images of women main characters. There, and I kept my last name because it's my name. But sometimes, I will tell you a quick story. I must tell you, look, there's sexism in the world. And there's sexism in reviewing and buying decisions and all that stuff. I will tell you a quick story. I was in, when you tour, you have the somewhat mixed experience of being in bookstores when people are looking at your book. So I was at the Atlanta bookstore, the Atlanta airport. I'm watching a guy, this is a couple years ago, pick up my book. He looks at the front, he looks at this completely Photoshopped fictional person on the back, fine with me, erase those years, okay, whatever. Reads the cover flap, which I write, all the part says how great I am, I write that. And who's gonna do it better? And he spends like 20 minutes with the book, honest to God. I'm watching. Is this guy gonna? He's gonna buy it. Is he gonna buy it? I'm gonna misplay. Anyway, the bottom line is he does not buy the book. In which case, I step in and I buy the book for him. Yes, I went to the counter. I bought the book. I said, "Sir, I'm this. Well, I'm not this virgin, but I'm the author." And I would like you to have this book, because I know you'd like it, because I know it's good, and I can see. But I got to ask you why you didn't buy it, because you thought about it. And I really want the feedback. I mean, I say, arrange the quote, I do all this. And he said, I never buy a book by a woman author. And I said, well, you still haven't. You cheap bastard. No, but I mean, you know, but I didn't say that. I said, give it a chance, is all I'm asking. Because I think that's hook. I'm bulletproof at this point. Things bounce off me. And he took the book and he read it and he wrote me an email 3 days later. He said, I really loved your book. You write like a man.
Oh.
But no, that's okay. That's great. I'll take that. So when you say the question, gee, that does kind of bug me sometimes that there are men who won't buy you, there are women who won't buy you, there are women who are sexist. And so what can you do? You can't I'm glad, if my whole thing is very keep it real, which I think is sort of like who I am and I can't help it, it's very South Philly of me, then it's got to be my name. That name was on briefs. I never changed it when I got married and divorced. And it rhymes with fettuccine. I mean, it's just...
And scallopini.
Scallopini, I know. And scarantino. It's all a great, delicious mix.
Who did you read when you were working on the first book? Did you read legal thrillers? I mean, who?
I read them all. And I read them all now.
Mm-hmm.
I read really widely. And I love them all. But, you know, the weird thing is, it's embarrassing to admit, but who was in my mind was Nancy Drew. Which my best friend hates when I always say that, because she said, it makes your books sound like your kid books. But it's more the spirit of mm-hmm. Nancy Drew. And, you know, if you look at crime fiction and you think about the spec, because I love it, I study it, I mean, and so when you think about the spectrum of it, you'll think about the amateur sleuth, and then you go on a spectrum of power. So there'll be an expert sleuth, that would be like a Scott Turow type hero, John Grisham type hero, right? These guys, Perry Mason, and then you can go beyond that to more like a Jack Reacher, more omnipotent. You can go beyond that one more step to like Spider-Man, right? Isn't it the same really continuum? There's Nancy Drew at one end, and there's Superman at the other. And in a way, they're all notions of power, and I think authors exploring the limits from the center of the character to its very skin. What is the personal power of this author? And I always felt personally short and kind of insecure and potentially like powerless, ordinary. And that was, to me, the beauty of Nancy Drew. She was just like us, like in the real just like us, not the Us magazine way just like us. They show you doing things that are not like you.
Right.
I don't get pedicures. Can we just say that? All right, so they're all getting pedicures.
Yeah, what for?
I know, exactly. So, right, you can't pedicure a bunion, so it's not attractive. So anyway, this is a long way of saying the person I channeled, which I hoped was original, was all of us. All I wanted, my secret agenda was have the greatness that is a real woman in the books. Every single one of them is real. They're not exceptionally gorgeous.
Right.
They're not exceptionally thin. They don't have a perfect life. It's not aspirational in that way. It's just, I hope, representational. Look at me getting carried away. It's the election season. Vote for me!
So there's a book that you should definitely read if you haven't, called
what?
Confessions of a Teen Sleuth. And it's a fictional biography, autobiography of Nancy Drew.
Get out!
You've got to read it.
Oh, because I've read The Girl Detective.
It's by, oh, yeah, this is, I mean, this book is just fabulous. It's by Chelsea Kane.
Really?
It was before she wrote
got
all
dark.
Her thrillers.
She's
before
terrific,
she got
though.
Oh,
she
yeah,
is
she
terrific.
Is. She is.
She's from out here.
Portland.
Yeah, exciting.
Yeah. So you have to read it.
I will. See, I read what you tell me to read.
I might have to just send it to
no,
you.
No, I will buy it.
Well, it's out of print, but so you have to search. But
I'll search.
But okay, it's so wonderful. It's so funny. You will adore it. And so it has all the people in it, Nancy Drew and Bess and George.
Bess and George.
And
and the Roadster doesn't have the Roadster because the Roadster's
kid. And Nick Nickerson. And so I have to say, she marries Nick Nickerson.
Really?
But she's still in love with one of the Hardys. What are their names?
Oh, Tom now the Hardy Boys?
Yeah, who were Tom and... What are
they would never amount to anything. I could.
Well, I don't know when you read that last page.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
One becomes a venture capitalist
right,
and moved to Seattle. And I go in the... Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I'm
go
just
ahead.
Going, no, it's just silly. I'm just having fun and forgetting it's supposed to be something better than that.
No, it's... Well, that's like, supposed to be you.
Well, that's scary, but...
All right. Well, wait.
Sorry, I got us way off.
You didn't. I got us way off. But you have to read that book because I think
I
you will adore
absolutely
it.
Will.
You will love it. So, do you have a writing routine?
I do. Even though, I mean, you can see I'm the least disciplined person you ever met. But and it's just that I work every day. That's it. That's the routine. In truth, I have a quota. Uh-huh. I have a little quota I make myself. But that's a good thing. It's 2,000 words a day. Some days I will get that, I'll start generally around 9, and sometimes I'll get done at 6, and then I'm like, woohoo, I rock. Some days it takes me, well, it used to take me till Colbert. Now it takes me till Colbert and another station. But that's a good thing to have, in my opinion. Because if anyone out there is thinking about writing, I think it's really, writing is behavioral. Like, and especially if you're a girl, if I can just say so, we overthink everything. I thought about writing for a long time before my back was against the wall. And so it's like, we're always going to second guess. And sometimes you just have to sit. Nike's my God. It's like, just do it. Just sit down and do it. And the thing about the 2,000 words is if you do that, I mean, I'm writing 2 novels a year in a nonfiction collection. You can meet all your deadlines, which you must because you're supposed to be grown up. And the other thing about that that is secretly good is that you can stop. When you work, I live alone. This is where you find out I have no personal life. I love my life. I'm very lucky, but I live alone, and basically I work, and I have animals. If you go on my Facebook page, you know them. Please come and see. And so I don't do a lot else but read and write and play with animals. And so you see why I'm celibate. anyway, this is a long way of saying...
It has something to do with all the popcorn, too.
Yeah, the carbohydrates are definitely... But the point is that when you work, and if you anybody here works at home, you know that you can feel guilty if you're not doing it. So when you get to 2,000 words, you can say, I don't have to feel guilty. I can read without guilt. I can watch Bravo TV. You know, I can do whatever I want to do. So a quote is a good, it works both ways for me. So that's my routine. I don't have any outline. Are you surprised? Someone who's getting a divorce when their child is, you know, like I said, it's not like a good planner. But I think it works for me. Probably the authors you speak to. My sense is half have outlines, right? And the other half are the kamikaze crazies like me. These people balance their checkbooks. These people, like, you know, they're fun to dinner, though. They're a lot of fun. So I just go all the way through, and I basically tell myself the story. Like, the surprise ending is a surprise to me. I'm like, oh, my God! I'm pretty sure this isn't how it's supposed to work. The only downside to that, am I being too, like, caffeinated?
No. Do you want your coffee?
Please, God. Can you imagine? What happens when you spend all your year inside, then they let you out of your little cage. Then you're like, blah, 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 blah. The only downside to doing the way I do it is because you're completely anxious all the time. Because you don't know if you have a story that has a beginning, a middle, and an end. Or as R.L. Stein says, a quote I love, a beginning, a middle, and a twist. Mm-hmm. That's what you like, to me. I see a lot of story that isn't a great story because there's no twist. Mm-hmm. I could say one. But no, let's not.
No, say it. Go ahead. Tell, I mean, because I'd love to know who you love. I mean, you love the Jack Reacher books. You love Lee Child.
I love him pretty much. I love David Baldacci. Mm-hmm. I love Mike Connelly. Everybody's different. You know, it's just like ice cream. Sometimes you're in the mood for chocolate and sometimes vanilla. And so it's sort of the mood. I love Janet Ivanovich. Mm-hmm. I love Kristen Hanna. I love Jodi Picoult. I love quality. I love quality commercial fiction. Now, what does that mean? I love quality fiction that moves fast. And if a book sells a lot of copies, that doesn't mean to me that it's bad. It could mean that it's good. In fact, right, that works with Seinfeld. It doesn't work with everything, but I like quality stuff. I always feed myself quality stuff. Nonfiction as well. We were talking earlier about, I was reading the Amanda Palmer's The Art of Asking, a book I didn't think I would like, and I did like a lot. I read self-help. I'm like a geek. I read like everything. I love memoir. Sedaris. I read this summer Gary Steingart. Mm-hmm. Little Failure. She's just like great. Augustine Burroughs, Mary Carr, Ann Beatty. Right? These are the people we all, these are just great. Mm-hmm. There's just great authors in this country and other countries. Denise Mina.
Too scary.
She's a little dark. You gotta be in a dark mood. But the sentences are good.
Yeah.
Philip Roth said he became an author because he loved sentences. Look at me, quoting and quoting.
You are. That's so
I'm trying to impress you. Yeah. You know, I took a course at Penn with Philip Roth. I got into a year-long course with him. And so I said to my daughter once, actually I said it at some speech thing, and I said, well, actually I studied under Philip Roth. And then I was like, and she said, Mom! I'm like, oh my God, it's so great! I studied it.
You took a writing course?
No, actually.
You were in the same class.
He gave two courses at Penn that were year-long. He gave a writing course, which I, not surprisingly, since I'm a female, was too insecure to even try. Mm-hmm. Could not declare that I was interested. So I took the reading course because I knew I could read. The reading course, here's the two semesters. The first semester is the literature of desire. Do you want to take a course with Philip Roth, your literary crush, called The Literature of Desire? Oh, yeah. 15 women in a seminar, all like this. We all wash our hair that morning. We all look. So I look around at these women who I'd seen at the dorm going, I don't even recognize you. It's like an author picture. And the second half of the course, more seriously, was Literature of the Holocaust. Why he put those together, I don't know, and there was no connection. But it was really fascinating, and I think he taught me a lot about reading, frankly. And I think if you want to write, read. So it all kind of worked out.
Right. So I interviewed Judy Blume.
How cool.
So that was pretty cool. But she told this wonderful story. I interviewed her 3 times in 3 months, over the course of 2 months, I think.
Wow.
3 times in different places. But she told this story about the time that her mother ran into Mrs. Roth, Philip Roth's mother, at what I believe was a kosher butcher.
Mother?
Yeah, Philip Roth's mother.
I feel like I know so much about her.
Yeah. Well, so Mrs. And this is right after Judy Blume's book Wifey came out, which was so shocking in 1979 and everything. And so Mrs. Roth said to Mrs. Blume, people will ask you, how does she know those things? And this is what you say to her. She said, Mrs. Roth said, you say, I have no idea, but not for me.
So I'm tempted to tell a story that's off the point, but that reminded me.
No, go ahead. This was totally off the point.
Well, if you were going to say, where did the strong women come from? It's from my mom. And permit me to tell this brief story.
Please.
And you'll see at the end why it ties in. My mother lived with my brother in Miami. She didn't want to live with me. She said, all you do is read and write. And I was like, you're very boring. And my brother's gay, and they're automatically more fun than straight people. So she went to live with him, and one morning, this is a quiet Sunday morning, she woke up convinced there has been an earthquake in Miami. She went and woke up my brother, there has been an earthquake. He said, Mom, go back to sleep. She went across to the neighbor and said, there's been an earthquake. He said, Mary, please go back to sleep. Beautiful Sunday morning. She goes in, and for a reason we will never know, calls the Miami Herald. I would like to report there has been an earthquake in Miami. They said, you might be crazy. She takes his name, because my mother had the list. You know what the list is called. I'm trying to keep it clean, so I won't. He took her name. Evidently, he keeps the list, too. Anyway, they hang up the phone. 2 minutes later, more like 5 minutes later, he calls her back. Mary Scottoline, there has been an earthquake. I know. I tried to tell you. You made me feel old and crazy. Long story short, a news van comes to her house. On the TV screen under her face, it says, Earthquake Mary. This she loves. Now, what's amazing about this story is that the earthquake did not occur in Miami. It occurred in Tampa. Do you understand what I'm telling you? Do you understand? My mother, proof positive, felt it the moment it occurred north when she was out. So the headline of the, you can Google this, I even wrote about it, but the Miami Herald headline was, it was a Sunday morning, and Mary Scottoline was the only person in all of South Florida who felt an earthquake that occurred in Tampa, and when we went to her lawn, oh, by the way, before I tell you the line, my brother for the TV show was in an unfortunate stage of wardrobe for him and was wearing a mesh t-shirt. The better for you to see the map of Italy tattooed on his chest. I'm not making this up. I'm sure Amy Tan would have no such story like this. Okay, so he's in the back of the, if you ever saw this film, you see him in the background trying to show you Milan on his left side. I digress. They said to my mom, how is it that you're the only person who knew this? And she said, because I know these things.
Wow.
Just what you said.
Yeah.
That's why I remember the story. Don't mind me. Isn't that incredible?
Yes.
That happened. Now, when you have a mom like that.
Yeah, you have a lot to live up to.
Yeah, yeah. But also, you're not going to write, like, somebody's not going to pour coffee in your book. She's going to be the star. I sound like just trying Tracy Morgan. Didn't I? A little bit?
Yeah.
She's going to be star. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay. Go ahead.
No, please. Stop me. Why? Before I kill again.
Here's a question I'm always interested in.
So, yes.
So you start off, a writer starts off with a character, and you really, when you're writing the book, you didn't think there would be a whole series of books about Bennie Rosato.
Right.
So you make all these decisions with that first book.
Right.
Relationship happen, and things happen, and you construct a background, whether it's all in there or not, but you have background and everything. And then, lo and behold, it's popular, and you know they want you to write more. So did you ever...
No, that isn't what happened.
Oh, what happened?
What happened was I missed them, which gives you an idea of how terribly lonely I... And I don't want to let them go. And I said, I would like to make it a series, and they said... You didn't say that. And I was like, I know. And they said, well, okay, give it a shot. And like much things, whenever you're writing anything, the great thing about this country, really, is you prove it. Like, no one's going to, like, make it all better. You have to show them.
Uh-huh.
So that's, but to interrupt.
Okay, so did you regret any of the decisions that you made about Bennie as a writer, you know, that you were then stuck with? Like, I once talked to somebody who said, his lawyer was married in the first couple of books or first three books, and then he realized that he couldn't go anywhere with that because this guy had a wife.
Huh.
You know, so he had to, like...
Well, I smell a murder afoot, don't you? This is not horrible.
It's a fatal illness, I think.
Oh, okay, whatever.
So, but did that ever...
The truth is, I'm writing each book, it's like kind of in a way organic. Somebody told me to say it's organic instead of haphazard. But you're trying to invent the character, and then what starts to happen, especially in a series, now I'm writing a series, and also writing standalones. A series is an examination of character over time, and sort of the way events change character. I never realized that, I just deconstructed it. I taught it to myself. And I taught it to myself by living. So like, for example, I lost my mom. She passed away. I would say I lost her, it sounds weird, but. You know, I'm different, right? You're a different person. Things change you, and that's what you start to examine. So it's just so organic that I never looked back and said, oh, it all happened. The weird thing is it becomes some kind of, I know this sounds so full of it, but you almost put yourself into a little spell, and you're telling the story to yourself. It actually proceeds from a logical point, which we learned in law school, which is what would this character logically do next? And that's why secretly, this is the NPR part of our show, why plot and narrative and voice are all the same thing. You know, people say, well, wow, the plot, the narrative, like these are separate. They're not, any more than mind and body are separate. The character is what the character does, just like us, and so, then the plot is propelled forward at the same time as the character is revealed to herself. Sometimes, if you've lived long enough, and I have, you surprise yourself sometimes. You're like, oh, I thought I was going to be fine with that. I'm not. Or I thought that was going to be hard. Piece of cake. Yeah. Right, and that's what you want. So I guess it's the longest answer I could have just said no. And then you would have been had your answer.
I can't even remember the question. I remember the question. That was a very good answer.
Thank you. It's all the truth. I just thought of it. No one ever asked me that.
And I loved that you deconstructed it yourself.
I did. Isn't that weird? Nice. But that happens too, doesn't it, in the world?
Yeah. What? Which
in your
part
life,
of it?
Anything.
Oh, that you discover who you are?
You just discover that that's the way this works because it's almost like you invent the wheel in your life.
Well, it's sort of like you invent your life as you go along.
Exactly.
Okay.
That's exactly. God. I should go on a date.
So there's not a lot of sex in your books, I've noticed.
As in life. No, I wrote a sex scene in this book, and I wrote it from memory. And the sad thing is now I don't really remember. That's what's really bad. And it's true. And that, you know, sometimes I've gotten email from people who go, why don't these women ever, like, you meet somebody that it's, and stay with them? And I know they want that. And that's part of a little what happened with this book. I sort of thought, Bennie is such a, I don't want to say she's a great character, because it sounds like I'm bragging, and I'm not. I think she's
no,
herself.
She is a great character.
She's a pretty great character, and she, right? I mean, I hope so. So in any event, she needs a great love. And I wonder what a great love is, and I certainly haven't had one, but you know, just hoping. I ain't dead yet, and though I lack estrogen. So I thought, I wonder what happened with her. And this is going to be the book that tells me in a funny way. So there's a little sex scene. Who the hell knows? Honestly, if that's why you're reading me, we're both in trouble.
Is that when you had to call your girlfriend up to
In fact, one point we had dinner, right? And I said, listen, honey, this is my best friend who has dates. And I go, what, can you remind me what happens? I know you start with kissing, but what happens after that? And so I'm actually, I have a yellow legal pad, because I still have yellow legal pads, and I feel like legit. And the waiter is like, what the hell is going on? Don't mind us. I'm at work. I get paid for this. But you know, you do have a logistical problem. I mean, I'm supposed to be. I was president of Mystery Writers. I take thriller writing very seriously. I like characters that have issues. And you can't credibly get a character. The difference in a mystery and a thriller is a mystery, the protagonist is not generally in trouble. That's the difference. Thriller, you're going to have a protagonist who at some point is going to be under mortal threat. This book is more mystery-ish. I won't give anything away. But in a thriller, if people stop to have sex, I'm never buying it. And you know, and they're always written by men, and you know the sex sucked. Like, if you had 30 seconds, and then you segued, we know how that was. Was it good for you? Yes. Was it good for me? Absolutely not. Please, I couldn't eat a pizza. Like, you know, I'm sorry, being terribly bad.
It's wonderful.
I'm trying to, you know, it's be real.
Yeah.
Telling it. Yeah. Right? You know it's a true thing.
I know.
Okay, I'm just saying.
I know you are a true thing.
No, I mean what I'm saying is also true.
Oh, no, right. Yeah, but good Nancy says. Good
Nancy. I'm a Nancy Black girl to go out.
So why did you start writing standalones?
Well, partly because I wanted to show women in other... what situations that were sometimes, because I was writing about women lawyers, people said these are legal thrillers. And because I'm a person who quit being a lawyer, and I think frankly women never really define themselves by their job. Happily for us, it's one thing that society, you know, I think it's an unfair thing they do to men. Oh, if you say to a man, like, they'll go, I'm an accountant. I go, no, actually you're a man who does accounting. But in any event, we don't think of ourselves that way, and I never did. So I never thought of them as lawyers per se. Look how lawyerly that sounded. But so I said, well, Lisa, you can't whine about people calling them legal thrillers if all the characters are lawyers. Like, change it. And also, I wanted the freedom to write about a more situation. Mm-hmm. Like, I just handed in the next one, which I kind of like, and I never could have done within a series. I can tell you about it because it's kind of like wild idea. But it was a wild idea, and you get to do the wild ideas. Because if you look at the standalones, they start to examine, like, there's Save Me and Look Again. There are bunches of books that they sort of examine, what is a mother? Is a stepmother a mother? Is an adoptive mother a mother? How are they different? Then what is a father? Don't go. You're trying to write about something big. And then I started to look at, I was watching TV, and the long story short is, the next book is called Most Wanted. And here's what it's about. An infertile couple can't make a baby because the husband is infertile. And the woman decides to use a sperm donor, and she uses a sperm donor to become pregnant, and then one day on TV, she sees her sperm donor being arrested for a suspected serial killing. Yes, that's a very good reaction.
Oh,
I appreciate
God. Yeah, that.
That
was a great reaction.
Now that's like, thank you for that. And I was like, I got that idea watching CNN, and I was like, that would be good. Thank God I write standalones so I can go a little, you know, definitely off the reservation. And try to look at how that couple would relate and what would happen next and what would this woman do and what about that whole issue of infertility, and by the way, how we treat egg donation differently from sperm donation, which is very different in this country, insanely different.
And talk about that.
Well, the headline is this. There are no laws about any of this. There are not even, there are regulations that are FDA that are guidelines, which is honestly criminal. So if you're an egg donor, that's called donor even though you sell that, you are given a 90-minute mental health exam, psychological exam by a mental health professional, in addition to having your blood screened for all manner of contagious diseases. If you are a sperm donor, you get nothing, except for the blood test. Mm-hmm. There is no psychological screening for sperm donation. You can see why the economics are different. Egg donation involves some economics. It's a more invasive procedure. But the other reason is, it's just sexism. Honestly, that's the reason why male infertility is so behind female infertility, which I wanted to write about. So it sort of was appalling to me, and every single book I write, whether it's the standalones or these books sort of have law front and center. Some reviewers said the main plot is crime, the subplot is family. And the April books, the main plot is family, the subplot is crime. I'm like, that, Gia, I planned it that way. That's a great thing. You like, they think you're smarter than you are. You're not that smart. So anyway, that got me mad a little bit. And I was like, because you can see that there's an industry, the sperm banking industry, preying on people at their most vulnerable. And it becomes even more important now with same-sex marriage. Mm-hmm. And that was a whole interesting thing. And I was like, this should change. So it's my little campaign to dramatize it. I don't want to make it sound like I'm writing treatises. I think I'm writing entertaining stories, but mm-hmm. I think, look at these people, they're smart. If you're trying to write entertainment for smart people and you learn something, you get to tell it to them. And that's what I really like.
Do you like, I know the answer to this question, but you love interacting with your fans and
love.
Your readers.
Love.
Were you always a people person?
Yeah, I'm ill-suited to being in my little cage all year round. My daughter said something I thought was kind of cool. She said, you know, there are some writers write to go within and become more introverted. You really write to connect. I think that's kind of true. I think it's actually much more not about me. To me, it's about books. You know, I mean, as we started to say, I have book clubs to my house every year. I've been doing it for 10 years. If you read my April book, you come to a party at my house. It's 550 people. And it's a gas, right?
Over 2 days.
550 one day, 550 the next. It's basically, I give a wedding. It's crazy. But it's really fun. And book clubs are proof, the way books connect people. Mm-hmm. And there's, as you know, more book clubs than ever before. And a lot, who here has a book club, right? And a lot of people are in more than one book club. And book clubs have 10 and 20 years standing. And I've sort of said this before, but it's a true fact. If I go to a book club meeting, which I have done, first 5 minutes are always about the book. Next 55 minutes, my dogs, my grandkids, my carbohydrates, my cholesterol. And always what happens is a woman, because we women apologize, a woman will say, I'm really sorry, Lisa. We're supposed to be talking about your book. And I say the same thing, which is, you are. Books is what connect people. So in a way, even the authors that are introverted, if you're writing something true, and that's why the truth part matter, it's the truth that connects. It's the truth that connects. And it brings everything to some kind of place that has to do with some vital connection between people that I sometimes think is about love. Weirdly enough, it's really about a connection. And it becomes about all of those things like truth and beauty and justice and love all become of a piece when they're wrapped up in the truth. And it only comes, all the arts do that. I think the arts do that.
Yeah.
Don't they?
Yeah.
That's why
I
they
agree.
Matter. That's why they speak, that's why books speak to your soul. I sort of, you know, I'm on the plane today and I see all these people playing Candy Crush. And I don't want to be value judgmenty, whatever makes you happy, but, or they spend an hour, I've wasted time online, Gawker, Perez Hilton, Publishers Weekly, whatever the site is, Twitter, God knows. But I feel differently. If I read for an hour, I'm calmer, I'm centered in a way that I'm not if I read online, jumping around.
So were you reading a book on the plane today?
Yes, I did.
What were you reading?
I'm reading old school Nelson DeMille. I'm reading Cathedral. And I bought a bunch of great books today. I just finished the Amanda Palmer. And that's the great thing about plane flights, because I'm a bad flyer, so I sit there all day. But And Nelson DeMille's one of the greats.
My favorite of his has always been Charm School.
Charm School's great. The Lion is my favorite of his. Because you can read that now and it's fresh. It's not even that old. You really understand a lot about the Middle East and the terrorism and all that stuff. He's good at switching viewpoints. Actually, he and I are going to be we're doing for charity, a international thriller writers is putting together a thing called Matchup, Face-Off. I don't know what the hell they're calling it. Something like that. But it's like his character, John Corey, against Bennie Rosato. So we have to write together, which I'm kind of excited about.
So I want to recommend another book to you.
Please do.
It's called The Good Son by Michael Gruber, who is a local writer.
But I think I bought that book, but I have not read it.
It's about a son whose mother gets kidnapped in Pakistan, and she's a psychiatrist. And he goes to rescue her. He's a special forces person. It's a wonderful book.
That would be so useful to have a son who's in special forces. Yeah. What is that? I love my daughter to death, but I said to her, why weren't you a vet? We could really use a vet. Sorry, did you guys say that? Yeah, that sounds great.
Yeah. When my children were little, I always wished my husband, who was taught psychology in college, but I always wished he were a pediatrician.
And right.
When they were little, and now I really wish he was an IT person.
Yes. Nobody cooperates in the careers you choose for them. Right. They don't love us enough.
Do you choose all your titles?
I don't. The ones, yes. And when I sort of brought Rosato and DiNunzio back, because what happened is Mary DiNunzio got to make partner, and I was like, it can't be Rosato and Associates anymore. She's sort of the mouse that roared, and so now it has to be Rosato and DiNunzio. You should really try to get your act together, Scottoline. And that's why I started naming them like accused, betrayed, corrupted, right. ABC, you get it? You know why. Sue Grafton is almost done. She's on X. I have a hard time with titles. The best titles I have are the ones I do with my daughter in the summer, because she titles them. So last summer was Does This Beach Make Me Look Fat?
Right.
And this summer is going to be I've Got Sand in All the Wrong Places. she just comes up with these things. The one she came up with, she's Mom, I have the best title for us. It's Have a Nice Guilt Trip. And I was like, you know, when your kid comes up, you think that really fits us? She totally, it fits us.
So when you're writing with her, do you ever come to a point where you're like at loggerheads, like you want to do this and she wants to do that?
Well, part of my secret goal was, you know, in getting more positive images of mothers and daughters into the culture. Like, we're tight. She's my best friend. We love each other. We also fight. But we write separate essays, and we write them separately. As she always says, we need to write across state lines. I'm like, that's funny. It's a little angry. But I like it, because then and what has happened over 6 years is 20-somethings find her, and 40-somethings find me.
But time
is 7:52,
and the bookstore will be closing in 8 minutes.
Exciting.
So please make your final
attention. Attention, Kmart shoppers. But the coolest thing that ever happened with those books is that, so that we don't know, I don't know what she's writing about. And the truth is, I don't want to know. Like, as she said to me once when I sort of said, do you really need a semicolon there? She was like, Mom, I have one mom. And I'm sort of like that type anyway, you know. Like, I still have on my refrigerator door. You've seen my refrigerator.
Yes,
yeah, there's stuff from like sixth grade. I'm like, look at this rainbow, it's so good. Anyway. Once she wrote a column about how she reads the wedding announcements and becomes nervous because she says, well, this person got married at 30 and I only have 2 more years to meet somebody. And then we put them all together at the end, and I realized that I had written something about reading the obituaries and going, oh, this person died at 82, so I only have a couple more years to live. And we're both like completely nervous, but about different timelines. I have no idea what she's going to write about, so we don't have push and pull over that. What parent doesn't want their kid to find their own voice,
right?
His or her own voice. So right. I don't have anything to do with it.
But you have fun together.
We do.
I mean, all those pictures of you with her are very loving.
Well, it's really fun, and it's really, We drove around on tour together, and then she started filming me. I was like, did you see that?
Yes.
Like, I was singing Under the Sea. You know, like, I'm like, does Lee Child know the lyrics to Under the Sea? I don't think so. Like, I'm trying to get to be serious. I'm like, but then I said, screw it, put it up. What the hell? And then everyone starts writing, darling, it's better down where it's wetter. Yes, it is! Who doesn't want to go where the people go or whatever?
So when you, with your first book, Not Mary,
now it's
a little lamb.
Everywhere the Mary.
Everywhere the Mary.
Terrible title.
No,
yeah,
it was my mind. But anyway, so they're all Italian Americans. I mean,
no, some are.
Well, but I mean, Benny is.
Well, the funny thing is, I try to play with it. Well, do you have a question? So I want to interrupt you. My daughter's like, you interrupt.
No,
interrupt
away. Did you think
Thank
that was
you.
Important? I think interrupt. Fine.
Well, the way I thought of it was this.
Fine, interrupt.
I have figured out that my best friend, we go to dinner, and we basically interrupt each other so much that we are having two parallel track conversations. Like, we're both talking at the same time, all the time. Anyway, what was the question?
Did you think it was important to have Italian Americans
in your
books?
I thought it was important to have Italian Americans. I thought it was important to have Jews. I thought it was important to have women. I thought it was important to have people of color. I also wanted to have, and I only made Bennie, Mary DiNunzio is so Italian, and that's sort of me, that I wanted to put Bennie in to secretly contrast. So I made her Italian American. She has absolutely no Italian Americanness. She doesn't relate to her ethnicity. So I only made her Italian for the contrast.
Mm-hmm.
And that I set that up. I think it's all part of a characterization. We were talking before about how much we both love character-driven novels. That's the thing about Nancy Drew. You sort of remember, I think you remember the Roadster, and you remember her boldness and her pluck and her characterization. You don't remember anything happens. Right. She's always something's missing. So what? It's usually a clock. It's some form of clock. And also the staircase, which is the part I never makes any sense. Like, I know where the staircase is. The cell phone is lost, but the staircase is right over there. So she, I think I wanted these characters to be so real, wanted to go deep. I also wanted to give them context. If you think back in terms of justice in fiction, Perry Mason, you didn't even know if Perry Mason had a family.
Right.
The original, as great as those books were, and kind of started the genre, unless you go back to Merchant of Venice, which we could do, and even Shylock had a characterization. He has a daughter. He doesn't get along with her. He feels, he's a really fully realized character. It's, we're the ones that took the lawyer and said, here's a tie, get in the courtroom, that's all lawyers do. And then it wasn't until Anatomy of a Murder that kind of, well, there's where he lives. And I always felt that since women, if I can say, what was my contribution? I was like, where can I fit to try to get published? And when I wanted to get published, it was like, well, if I'm a girl, you're going to know that I'm going to have a best friend, and we're going to talk about everything. So she's going to have a tight best friend. And there might be a man, or we're going to talk about a man. And she's going to be insecure. And by the way, when she stands up in front of a jury, she's going to have what I have, which is, I would burst into thorns. I looked like, because I was nervous. And so it was a tell. So you stand in front of juries all the time, but I would have to wear turtlenecks. It would be like 70 degrees. I would look like Diane Keaton or maybe A9. So I wanted the characterization. What sport does she play? What does it tell us about her? Bennie is a rower. But I was a rower, but are you surprised to know that I rode an 8? No, because I'm friendly. I like people. I rode an 8. I want to do exactly what you do at exactly the right time. Not Bennie. So everybody who's writing anything worth reading is giving you the telling detail for a reason. Even the Roadster is the telling detail in Nancy Drew to tell you who she is. And so ethnicity is part of that.
Mm-hmm. But just part.
Yes, but I feel like there's not enough ethnicity, really, sometimes, especially in mainstream fiction. We could do a little more of it.
Mm-hmm.
We certainly could use more diversity.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that's up to Caucasian writers, including diverse characters, or should we be trying to nurture and mentor other people of color and the voices that they would bring to
definitely
the genre.
Definitely the latter.
Yeah.
I mean, the answer probably would be nice if it were both, mm-hmm. except there's a part of me that says, God, in a creative endeavor, don't tell people what they should write.
Right.
Like, it's America. You get to write what you want to write. And partly, I've had African-American characters. I've never had an African-American main character. Because I don't want to screw up. But for me, it was a big step to write a male main character. I was like, oh no, what do I do? And also, am I betraying my little bequest? And all the great, you know, actually most of my readers are men, but the people who brought me here and expect X,
good.
I'm going to give them Y. Actually,
the
a chromosome.
Time is so. And the bookstore is now closed. Please bring your final purchases to the near
future. Wah, 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 wah. So I'm going to ask one question and then we'll turn
yes.
it over.
We're fine, I've got a register open.
Okay.
We know somebody. Nancy knows somebody.
We got it paid. Mel will take care of all the sales for the book. Oh my God.
So anyway, I hope that more people write and I hope more diverse characters come. Because I think all this stuff has a role in visualizing. I always think, for example, we have a biracial president. We would not have had that, I think, if 24 hadn't had a black president. I'm just convinced of that. Mm-hmm. The more you see, like, Secretary of State and it's a woman, you go, well, that's not impossible, and the world won't end. And so we move forward because the art showed us how to visualize that. There's a great story about when the CIA was kind of, do you remember reading about this? When they were realizing what, they were wondering what would be the next attack. And that what they did was, truly, got a bunch of fiction writers in the room. It was a while ago. Mainly Tom Clancy, who I think never got, even though he writes big, thick books and it's all a lot of boy toys, never got enough credit for plot. Executive Decision is a book about flying a plane into the Capitol when it's in session. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is, the people who have been given permission to imagine do so. And the more you do it, the better you get at it. So I hope that you can give yourself permission. I can write a guy, and someday I'll write an African-American character, and hopefully I'll get it right. But in the meantime, I hope more different voices come to the mm-hmm. fore.
Okay, my one last question.
Good, I vamped for you, came to you.
Yeah, finally came to me.
God, I could go forever.
Are you, most of your readers really men?
Yes. Don't know how I know it, but they did
wow.
a little study at the publisher. And I will tell you briefly that, you know, I get email and I read it all. I used to be able to respond to it all, but I don't always respond now. But I will, especially the Bennie books, men will write, I love the issues of law and justice, and you got the appellate argument just right, and I always feel great. And the women will write about the same book, I hate pantyhose too, just like Ben. and they just find something different, each different, and that makes me so happy.
Yeah.
I can't tell
yeah.
you.
Lisa, I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for this, and thank you to them, my God.
Should we take some questions?
Do we have time? Or do you have
yeah.
Yeah, please.
In this book, I mean, first of all, I love all your books, and these characters I feel like I know. Like,
thank you.
Like I'm there, you know, in the office somehow. But this book, I found that Bennie was so much more vulnerable.
She was.
It's not because I'm ready.
She kind of was.
And so... why did you go that direction? I mean, I can see where it went with the story because of, you know, things
right.
like that, but she was just so much more vulnerable. Did you want to show that side that she wasn't, I always felt like she has this wall up.
Right.
And doesn't have fun with the rest of, you know, shows she's always working.
Right. Yeah, no, you're right, and I appreciate you saying that. I didn't set out to do it. It just sort of happened when the story came out. I was like, she's gonna think stuff. You try not to do too much internal monologue because that really can bore people to tears. But I think I, you know, Hemingway says, write drunk, edit sober. And not that I write drunk, but I basically get it all out and then I go, okay, enough already. You don't fall in love with your own voice too damn much. So I do think it showed more of that. And I think she keeps a lid on that. Mm-hmm. And I think in going back, and I think that happens as we get older too, you go, oh, I could have taken a chance there. I didn't really take that chance. And the book really becomes about, because this case comes around again and the man comes around again, I sort of thought that it kind of, I won't say devolved, but it didn't really devolve, it evolved into a novel of second chances so that you go to yourself, if I had a second chance, you think you'd do it different, would you? Because it called her bluff. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate you saying that, because she certainly didn't start out vulnerable, but she is a person inside there.
Yeah.
I didn't know until I wrote it.
What do you think Mother Mary would think of this book?
Oh, you're so sweet to ask. What would Mother Mary think of this book? I must tell you that Mother Mary, she was a high school graduate. She didn't read much. I don't think anyone in my family has ever read me. I know. Except my dad read one book. And but they loved me to the marrow. But I grew up in the house, you know, as I always say, there was like one book, and it wasn't the Bible, it was TV Guide, like nobody reads. But I know exactly what Mother Mary would say, because first of all, she was very proud of me. Although, as my father said, because a woman said to him at a sign, you must be so proud of your daughter, and he said, lady, I was proud of her the day she came out of the egg. How cute is that? But what my mother always did was tell me where the typos were. She would proofread my books. So she would let me know that on page 35, like, there should have been a period. But I know that she really loved me, and it really wasn't about anything I produced. Like, I grew up in a house where the refrigerator was really thick with all my rainbows. You know, even though they suck.
So nice.
Really, it's a gift, honestly.
Yeah.
I have a hard time writing a bad mother. Were you in an early book club when you met her?
Yeah,
I thought you were.
She had her stroke, and then I was there when she talked, and after she had her stroke and everything. Really,
yeah, you
just
guys.
The same as your mother.
Oh, I mean, you're just sweet. You guys were so nice to her.
Witty.
You're so sweet. I mean, because she'd come out to talk to the book club. Now look, these are people that I've invited to my home, which is already weird. But we're already in love, but I never know what my mother's going to say. Well, truly, I'm that way too. I don't know what it will say. And so I remember the time before she had the stroke, I got her out in front of everybody. It's all these lovely women. Everybody dresses up. They all look great. And my mother, she gets up there and she goes, she got me off the toilet to come out. You know, these are people who don't even curse, right? It's a classy crowd. It was like that. But thank you. Any other questions about anything? Feel free.
How many dogs do you have?
Oh. I'm so happy you're here. And you know what else I love? I saw you reading. Mm-hmm. And that's so great. You were sitting there reading. Would you like to read? I love to read too. Mm-hmm. And I have, how many dogs do you think I have? Take a guess on what's crazy.
Nine?
I should have nine, but I only have five. I have five dogs, I have two cats, and then while I was away on book tour, we adopted another cat who was hanging around our barn, and we named her Barney. I have 14 chickens, I have three horses, and I have a little pony named Buddy. It's a pretty full house. They call it a zoo.
That's a great question.
That is a great question. Oh. Well, maybe on that note. One more.
I mean, I followed this case when this was going on.
So you did?
Yeah. I don't know.
How did you find, there's a case in the book involving judicial corruption. That's all we'll tell you.
Horrible case.
But you did that here. How did you follow it?
I still read the Philadelphia Inquirer, and I go back to Pennsylvania and read the stuff. And like I told you, my sister was a legal secretary in New York County.
Oh, right.
She knows the judges.
Incredible.
I mean, this was real evil.
Real evil. Yeah.
So, have you spoken with any of the children whose lives they ruined? Thousands.
Well, that's why I wanted to write the book.
Yeah.
Interestingly, I have contacted two of the children. They're now in their 20s. Neither wanted to speak with me because they're hoping to make a movie about it, and the rights, they can't speak to anybody.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, so that's why I was left to imagine it. But the truth is, that's okay with me. I think I hewed pretty close to the record. As you know, there's an actual transcript which I modified a little bit. But there was a lot of research material. People don't know about it, even in Pennsylvania. So I was like, I'll use it as a jumping off point. The book is not about that. The book is sort of fashioned around it, as you say. But I loved that, I don't want to say I love that there's so much corruption, but I think in the world, in our politics, in our government, You know, there's so much money in this relationship between money and government and elected judges and merit-selected judges, which might be changing in Pennsylvania as we speak. Are judges elected here or by merit selection?
Both.
Do you know?
Both.
Both. You know, it's a really interesting question, and you sort of want to go, what is corruption? And try to examine the effect of corruption over time. So I was free to make it up. But the only, in answer to the question, I also talked to a psychiatrist who specializes in adolescents who are incarcerated. And I said, tell me what happens to the adolescent brain during incarceration. And it was really very interesting. And long story short, there's neural pathways that don't form that are supposed to form. So you actually create a felon. And by the way, it's not a felon who's going to serve time like 10 and 20 years. They're going to be out. And their lives are ruined. I really wanted to explore that. It's tough stuff, though. It's.
You should send those judges.
Well, they're in prison. They have a lot of time to read. There's one is serving 28 years, and the other's like 17.
But they can't get hardbacks, can they? Or is that still not a rule? I mean,
I donate hardbacks.
Oh, you do.
I donate to prisons and to police academies. Cops and robbers.
Because it used to be you could only send paperbacks. But maybe that's changed.
Not
Must have changed.
You just can't send e-books now.
Right. Well, Lisa, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank
it was
you,
wonderful.
Thank you. You are so amazing.
Well, that's it for me.